to Wednesday Experience. My name's Kevin. I'm one of the pastors here at Cooper City Church of God, and it's my privilege to join you this week as we share about the topic of restoration. We're doing a study throughout this month and want to turn your attention to our key verse, which is in Acts chapter 3, Acts of the Apostle chapter 3, verse 19 through 21. We're going to read there together, and I'm going to read from the New Living Translation if you want to read and follow along. The Word of the Lord. Now repent of your sins and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Then times of refreshment will come from the presence of the Lord, and he will again send you Jesus, your appointed Messiah, for he must remain in heaven until the time of the final restoration of all things, as God promised long ago through his holy prophets. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. I want to give you a definition of restore. We've been talking about times of refreshing, and today our topic is restoration. Restore is the act of restoring, renewal, revival, or reestablishment. To restore means to return something to a former, original, normal, or unimpaired condition. By definition, restoration tells us that there has been a time where things looked much different, much better than they look now. My wife is going to come in just a moment. She's going to share about her passion and her giftedness of restoring old furniture. In fact, I'm coming to you from our home today, and throughout our home, it's decorated with pieces of furniture that were quite honestly abandoned and forgotten by other places or other people. Some furniture she actually picked up on the side of the road, and others she found in barns and warehouses and antique shops where they needed a much needed upgrade and some TLC. And when she found some of these things in its original state, it was dilapidated and broken and just not usable. But there's something powerful about the charm and the rustic of taking an old piece and restoring it. Because you see, when these pieces of furniture had been originally created, they had a purpose, they had a plan, they had a destiny. But years of neglect and years of not caring for these pieces of furniture caused them to be discarded, many of them as junk on the side of the road. Now, just to be safe and to be sure and to be understanding, all of our furniture didn't come off the side of the road that we have in our home. She's very picky about the things that she would pick out, but it's a powerful testimony about how when the person has the right eye and can see good bones in a piece of furniture or something else that they want to restore, they can take it, and in many times they can restore it back to even better than it was in its original state. And some of these pieces of furniture had seen better days. And as I think about this as a pastor, I know a lot of people that their lives resemble old pieces of furniture. I hear their stories about how things used to be, how they used to have hopes and dreams, and how they used to think as a child, when I grow up, I want to be this or I want to be that. And even as an adult, they had aspirations. But I meet a lot of people as a pastor and as Christians, I bump into folks from time to time, and their lives resemble old pieces of furniture in this way, that they used to do this or they used to do that. For instance, they used to walk close with the Lord, or they used to have a deeper understanding of the scriptures and a deeper power of the Holy Spirit at work in their lives and a joy of fellowship with God. And they used to have these things, but then relationships started to sever and to fall apart, and promises were broken, and sin became to be tolerated in their lives, and then it was never confessed and had never been forgiven. And so because of their own choices and their own will, things turned and things moved to a broken state, a despaired state, and restoration has been needed. You see, the common thread in all of these lives is that there is unproductivity and there's brokenness and there is no longer the functioning of what we were intended to be made of as children of the Most High God. And when we get to that place, you and I are in need of restoration. Tonight, or today, whenever you're watching this, I want to talk about restoration as God takes broken things and puts them back together. He can restore our lives and he can put them back into the original state of what the purpose and the plan is for you and I. God longs to restore us. And so beyond our main text from Acts, I want to read from the Bible in Zechariah. If you have your Bible, turn to Zechariah chapter 1, and we're going to look at Zechariah. And we're going to journey with a group of people who were perhaps in one of the most difficult times of their life. The children of Israel, the chosen people of Israel by God, they were in need of restoration, they were in need of renewal and revival. And here they are, needing to be reestablished in the Lord. And here we catch them in their journey. And the Word of God says in Zechariah chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, beginning with verse 2. Again, I'm in the New Living Translation. It says, I, the Lord, was very angry with your ancestors, and therefore say to the people, this is what the Lord of heaven's armies says. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Don't be like your ancestors who would not listen and pay attention when the earlier prophet said to them, this is what the Lord of heaven's army says. He says, turn from your evil ways and stop all your evil practices. Now, a little bit of background on this story. This picks up about 500 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. And Israel is no longer a prosperous nation. They're no longer the mighty military force that they once were. Nor is the city of Jerusalem beautiful like it once had been. Israel was in a mess. It was a real disaster. 80 years before this, Israel had been attacked and had succumbed to the nation of Babylon, and King Nebuchadnezzar was giving rule and reign over them. And the city of Jerusalem had been ultimately destroyed. The temple was burned, the walls were torn down, and the battle was over. And when the dust had settled, Israel had been soundly defeated. The people of the nation had been taken captive, and they would live as slaves in obscurity and in poverty for the next 70 plus years. Now, how did this happen? How could so much go wrong from a nation that had been a powerful force and a beautiful nation? The landscape and the architect and the cities, everything was just so wonderful. And then it turned disastrous in just a matter of a few decades. Well, the reality is that they neglected God. They rebelled and turned to their own ways. They started worshiping idols. They began to change their spiritual nature and their dependency and their humility before God. And it didn't happen overnight, but slowly there was an erosion and a decay of their moral compass and their values and their Christian values, to where it was such a terrible thing that it had been brewing for over years, and now the trouble had surfaced to such a degree. Does this sound familiar to anybody? Does it sound maybe like our nation? Does it sound like for many years and decades now, we've been in this turmoil, and it seems like the Christian Judeo values of our nation has been eroding away? And we find that the Word of God talks a lot about this erosion and about this type of drifting. I want to give you just a couple of passage scriptures in this study tonight. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 says this in the King James. Therefore, we must give, in verse 1 of chapter 2, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard. It says, lest we drift away. For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received as a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? Here, the writer of Hebrews is giving us confirmation of what may happen when we begin to drift, or when we begin to allow our values to erode away. Hebrews goes on to say again in chapter 3, Hebrews verse 12 and 13, beware, brethren, lest there be any of you of an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, but exhort one another daily. Here again, the warning call is given, and the shot is heralded across the bow, so to speak. And here we find the Word of God that is challenging us to not drift and not allow erosion to take place. It's a slow process. It's a slow and seemingly small thing, but it begins to build up, kind of like the snowball on the top of the mountain as it slowly begins to move down the hill. The farther it moves down the hill and the mountain, the more mass it begins to grow, and the more speed it begins to pick up. And by the time it's at the bottom of the mountain, it can turn into an avalanche. And so here we see again another passage of scripture in 1 Timothy chapter 1. 1 Timothy 1, verse 18, it says, Timothy, my son, here are my instructions for you. Based on the prophetic words spoken about you earlier, may they help you fight well in the Lord's battle. Cling to your faith in Christ, Paul writes to him. And he says, and keep your conscience clear, for some people have deliberately violated their consciences. As a result, their faith has been shipwrecked. Wow, what a powerful word to use to indicate this erosion and the separation and the just disastrous thing that had taken place in some of the people's lives that Paul was talking about when he was writing Timothy. So in his instructions to his apprentice, he's also instructing you and I, and each of these things gives us an example, not only in the Hebrews chapters, but also in 2 Timothy, where we see the reality is that these passages are peppered with neglect, the love of this world, the cares of this world, a hardened heart, and if we're not careful, it can actually happen to us. As a music major in college and going to a Christian liberal arts school, a lot of times we did study of ancient hymns and hymns of the faith. And one story I found about Robert Robinson, he was in England in 18th century, and on a Sunday morning he was walking despondently down through the city of London, and as he walked he noticed the sound of church bells ringing. And it had been some time that he had been to church, and his faith at one point had been strong, but he had eroded away. He had begun to allow the cares and the neglect of the world and all the things that entraps him with, it had taken over his life, and his heart was cold and his relationship with God was non-existent. He was distant. Robinson, as he walked, he heard the sound of an approaching horse-drawn cab, and so he waved it down, and as the cab approached, he saw the cab and already had a passenger in it, and so he waved it down and he got in. And when he got into the cab, the woman beside him offered to share the cab, and she asked if he was on the way to church, and he responded, "Yes, today I think I will go to church." Once he was in the cab, they exchanged some pleasantries and some introductions, and the young lady noted what a wonderful coincidence, because she had just been reading a verse by the same name of a person named Robert Robinson. And when he had introduced himself to her, she's like, "I've just finished reading something by a man of the same name." And he took the book that she held and he nodded and he said, "Yes, I wrote these words years ago when I was in a far different place. They are words that you and I now know from the great hymn, Come Thou Fount." You see, God was saying that day through these turn of events and through the circumstances, God permitted Robert Robinson to be reminded of the fact that, listen, it's not too late. Things are not so far gone. God was saying to him then, he was also saying to Israel through Zechariah, you can still fix this. You can still turn this situation. You may have fallen. You may have rejected me and you may have messed up, but it's not too late. And he is saying that to us today. He's saying that to you. He's saying that to me. It's not too late. You're not too far gone. You can still be restored. When he says, "Return to me and I will return to you," in Zechariah, God is displaying his mercy and his grace to Israel. God placed it on the heart of King Antaxerxes to allow Israel to return to the land and of their home. And they were grateful to be out of bondage, but looking around, they saw still the remains of war, and there was nothing but disaster. So they had to rebuild the wall. They had to work on the temple. And then they lost interest over time. They had very little money, and they had few resources, and they had little hope and confidence in their future. And then God speaks to the children of Israel, and he gives them this first step towards their restoration. He says, "Return to me, and I will return to you." Now, there's a paradox here in this "return to me," because when the Lord speaks through Zechariah, it seems that the responsibility rests on man to initiate the restoration. That is, it is up to Israel to pull themselves together and then come to God. But God says, "Return to me, and I will return to you." And while he's doing that, he says, "I've been working the whole time in getting you back." And I love this about the story, because we make the mistake of saying that we found God, or I found religion, or I found Christianity. And the truth is that we never have found God. God is always great in mercy and searching and looking for us. When Adam and Eve turned their back on God in the garden, it was God who came looking for them, calling out, saying, "Adam, where are you?" When Peter had denied the Lord, it was Jesus on the morning of the resurrection who said to the woman at the tomb, "Go and tell my disciples and Peter that I am alive." You see, God always initiates the work of restoration in our lives. We don't have to wait on the Lord. The Lord is waiting on us to come to our senses and to turn toward him. I mentioned earlier that my wife has a gifting and a passion for restoration of old furniture. We're going to hear from her now a story about restoration. Please take a look at this.
The word restore, or the act of restoration. When I hear those words, I'm reminded of an art collector named Steve Wynn who lives in Las Vegas. He's a very wealthy man who made his living off of selling expensive real estate. And over the years, Mr. Wynn began to lose his eyesight. I can't remember the name of the disease, but it has caused him to only see the perimeter of things. The center of his eyesight is what was affected through that disease. But he shares this story of one of his priceless pieces of art, his very first Picasso painting, and it's called Le Rêve. It means the dream. And he had paid $60 million for this piece of art. It was his favorite piece of art, and he had it for many, many years. And he says the art appreciates over time and it never loses its value. Well, one of Mr. Wynn's friends told him that he would like to buy the Le Rêve if he ever decided that he wanted to let go of it and sell it. And he said that he decided he could sell it, and he could actually buy a few pieces of art that he had been wanting for a while with the profit that he would make off of the sale of that one piece of art. So Mr. Wynn made a deal with his friend to sell the piece of art for $130 million. He tells the story of when the time had come to prepare the painting for the sale. He said he took it off the wall, and he had asked some of his other art friends to come over and view the Picasso in person, just for that one last time before he packed it up and he shipped it. And he said it was basically leaning up against the wall on this device to where they actually come and they remove the frame away from the canvas, and they take pictures of the edges of the canvas, and you know, they put on the gloves so as to not smudge the canvas because it's very, very expensive. And they do this for what they call the provenance. And a provenance is a record of ownership of a work of art or an antique, and it is used as a guide to determine the authenticity and the quality of a painting, and it's done for insurance purposes. And he said the whole payment had already gone through, and there were attorneys involved, and he said that $130 million was wired to his account. And he said because the next morning that painting had to be shipped out. So he was showing his friends one last time this beautiful painting that he loved so much, and he said, you know, I was leaning back to show them something that was in particular on that painting that always grabbed my attention. He said, it was one of the things that I loved most about this painting. And he said he began to make his way over to the painting. And he said, because of my diminished eyesight, I actually tripped and fell, and my elbow went through the painting. He said the first thing that I did after I picked up myself off the floor, he said I had to call my friend that had just wired me $130 million and let him know of what had just happened. He said that basically there are two choices that we have here. One of the options we have is that you can redeem this through insurance, and that means that they would just give the friend his money back, but they would have to keep that valuable painting. So, or he said, we can have it restored. And he had already made up his mind, he said, that if his friend was not willing to restore this beautiful piece of art, that he was going to just reverse the sale, and that he would take it upon himself to restore it himself because he loved that painting so much. And he did not want it to end up redeemed in the hands of insurance adjusters, he said, because most of the time they didn't know what to do with the damaged piece of art. He said, I'd had this painting for 20 years. It was special to me. It was my first investment that I made as an art collector. And he said, his friend said that he was new at collecting art, and he knew nothing about how to go about restoring a painting. So he said, you know what, you can just go ahead, and if you'll just reverse the sale and redeem my money, you can take it and you can restore it. So Mr. Wynn said it took about 2 years for him to find what they call a canvas surgeon. And one of the most renowned people that he found was this Picasso connoisseur. And this person found all of the right paints that they needed for the restoration. He said he actually had to go to the origin of the different countries to match the pigments exactly to that original painting. He said he worked on the back of the painting to bring that big gash or that big tear back together. And when he brought it back to me, he said, the gentleman said, "You're not gonna believe it." He said, "But if you look at the front of this painting, you would never know that anything has happened to it." He said, "Because the restoration was done so beautifully." He said, "But on the back of this painting, I actually had to attach the provenance or the record of the tear or the record of the damage. It has to be documented on this paper." And he said, "I have to place it on the back of the painting. And so now that the painting has been through this tear or it has been through a broken place, we actually have to track that on the painting. It's part of the art history," and he said, "we call that the provenance." So Mr. Wynn said years later, after the restoration was done, he was together again with those friends that he had invited to come see that painting for the last time. And they asked him, he was like, "Whatever happened to that painting? Do you still have it?" And he said, "No, I kept it for a while," but he said, "I went on to sell it for $159 million. They asked him, "My goodness, how is that possible with all the damage that we saw, your elbow going through the canvas of that painting? How in the world was that painting able to be sold for $159 million? Mr. Wynn said, "Because something in the art world called a provenance. A provenance makes the art more valuable when it has been through something and when it has gone through a restoration process." So it made me think, you know, how in the world can you explain how the art world understands that word restoration better than the body of Christ does? Why don't we know that the intrinsic value of something that has been restored means that somebody loved it so much, someone loved it enough to tend to it and to invest in it and to hover over it for many years to bring it back together with a thread of love, so to speak, very intricately. Everything that had been torn away and broken away and destroyed, the art world finds value when a piece has been through something like that. And it is still beautiful, and it still carries the weight of the intrinsic value of the initial investment that the lover that is attached to that piece found the worth in it, and it is worth more than it was in its perfect form after it was restored. The art of restoration is something that you and I are all undergoing all of the time. We are a steady canvas under the hand of the Holy Spirit. And that's where we are to be still. And that's so that we will know what our God is capable of doing for us. There are others of us that just want to have a quick fix. They want to put a band-aid on their brokenness over their beautiful artwork, and they want to call that restoration. The difference between redeeming something and restoring something refers to the 61st chapter of Isaiah, where it says, "To give beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness." We all have probably read that chapter, but this chapter explains to us the difference that there is between the redeeming of something and then the restoring of something. You see, if the insurance company would have issued a redemption for that painting, there would have still been they would have instantly made the owner of the painting whole financially because they would have got all of their money back. But it would also mean that something was going to be left undone. Something was going to be left broken, and something was going to be left unrestored. That painting, that beautiful painting that meant so much, was going to be left undone. You know, for many years I've enjoyed redoing furniture. I have a piece of furniture here in my home that I have redone. This old chest of drawers, when I found it, it was broken into pieces. The drawer fronts were actually falling off of it, and there were broken pieces all around this piece of furniture, but I liked how much storage that this chest of drawers could provide to hold a lot of my things. So I decided to tackle putting it back together. There were deep gashes in the sides. There were broken places that needed to be fixed. But you know what? I saw the value and I saw the potential of what this piece could become again if I could put it back together, and if I could restore it, and if I could make it somehow like it was before. You see, this is what Christ does for us. He says, come and rest under the shadow of my wing, and let me take care of you. Let me take care of your problems for you. You see, the painting was more valuable because of the restoration that it had gone through. You and I are more valuable because our Heavenly Father loves us and cares for us through our brokenness. And He covers us and He allows us to rest under that shadow, and He leads us through a restoration process. I'm so thankful that our Heavenly Father loves us that much. You know, many of our prayers are centered around God's redeeming something in us. When God, all along, he's standing over us and He's hovering over us and He's saying, please allow me just to come and restore it. Not just redeem it. I want to restore it. Please allow me to take your brokenness and to take your scars and to take your pain and to take all that ugliness in your life and let me restore it. It's worth more than what it was to begin with. Anything that you have that you think is not worth it, let the Father above take you under the shadow of His wings and let Him restore you once again.
As we see Cindy talking about the story of the painting, we are reminded of how God looks at us. He sees value in us. When we are restored, we are worth more and we are more valuable. And sometimes God has to permit us to go through a restoration process for us to truly be mindful and thankful for the restoring work of the cross of Calvary through His grace and mercy that has been given to us so freely. When we look at people, do we see them as God sees them? When we look at people, do we see them as Jesus saw them? In other words, do we see potential when we see people? Because that's exactly how God looks at you and me. He doesn't see us for what we are, or even in our current state, or the sum of our parts, or the sum of our past failures and flaws, but He sees us for what our preferred future can be. He sees us for the potential on the inside of us through the work of His Holy Spirit. God is loving, He's patient, and He is determined to be active in the restoration process for our lives. That's why He's searching out for you. For some of us, there are more damaged parts than working parts, but that doesn't hinder the work of God. In fact, I have found that often God can do an even greater work where it seems like we're at the end of our abilities or the end of our understanding of what we're capable of doing in our own power. That is when God steps in through the work of His Holy Spirit, and He picks up and He begins the process of bringing us back and the restorative process that we've been talking about today. Today, I believe that journey can be a reality for each of you. Wherever you are, whatever you're going through, whatever you're facing in this season of your life, and obviously we know that we're going through some very tumultuous times with the pandemic and all the things that are going on in our culture and our society, but none of these things have caught God off guard. God's not up in heaven wondering what He's going to do tomorrow. And God has a purpose and He has a plan, and He's going to fulfill that plan, not only with our world, but in your life individually. And so today I encourage you, as we pray, to submit to the restoration process, Whatever it is that God has purposed and designed for you, even though you've missed the mark, maybe you failed in the past, maybe you failed repeatedly, there is still a purpose and a plan that God has for your life, and He wants to fulfill that work in your life, and I believe He can do that starting right now. Can I just pray with you? Would you agree with me right now? Father, we thank You for this story of the children of Israel. We thank You, Lord, that we know that they were going through the most difficult of times, much of like what we as a nation are going through right now here in America. And God, just like You did for them, I believe You're speaking to us, that if we will return to You, that You will return to me. You will return to us. Lord, I believe that You are searching right now. You're looking for people who will be that remnant to say, I'm going to follow God, no matter the circumstance, no matter the situation, no matter the cost, I'm still going to follow after our Lord and our Savior. God, I ask You to do the work, sometimes the difficult work of restoring. When Cindy has returned and restored some of these pieces of furniture, it takes sanding and grinding and a lot of labor. And God, there are some things in our life that need to be sanded out and grinded out, and some things that need to be removed. And perhaps that removal is going to cause pain and disconnect. But God, fill those gaps and fill those holes and those voids with Your love and Your peace and Your kindness and Your joy. And I pray for those that are listening and watching right now, that Your restoration process would be made evident to them. Let us do our part, but let us lean into You and trust You, for Your part is really the work that has to be done. We submit to that right now in God's name. And we thank You for being a restoring God, for being a God of favor and a God of mercy and grace. We say these things, and so be it according to Your word. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. May the Lord bless you. Thank you for joining us today for Wednesday Experience. If this has been a blessing to you, I encourage you to share this with others and indicate to them where they can view this and listen to this. And may the Lord continue to bless you. We look forward to worshiping again with you. If not sooner, we'll see you this weekend at our church services at Cooper City Church of God. God bless each and every one of you.